If you could see the world through my eyes, vibrant purple sunrise, shards of broken dreams come raining down.
Slightly. All right, Mark here, Life and Fitness Files. Thank you for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe to stay up to date with videos and information that I am sharing. Today I want to jump into Zone 2 and Dr. Peter Attia's pillar of aerobic efficiency. There's four pillars he has in his regimen for overall exercise and fitness, but I do want to note that if you cannot do all of these pillars, start with one. And Zone 2, or some cardio as people might call it, aerobic efficiency, this is a great place to start and to build a foundation. So I'm going to be diving into what is it, what is Zone 2, what are the benefits, and how can I do it? How can I get started? What are some examples? What is it? Technically, in a super technical definition, it's the highest metabolic output while maintaining lactate below 2 millimole per liter. Okay, to most people, that's not going to mean a whole lot. There are lactate tests, very expensive, probably $200 to $300, not required. So to break it down, shooting for 80% of max heart rate. So if you want to do a quick calculation, 220 minus your age is a great estimate for max heart rate, then take 80% of that. For me, I typically try to stick around 140, but again, it's not scientific. I do not have a lactate test. That's okay. One thing to note here, for those of you who are using Garmin watches, this is actually in the zone 3, so in that mid to low green range. There's many different zone systems out there, so knowing that 80% of your max heart rate is going to get you in the ballpark, despite whatever zone system, sometimes that can be a little bit confusing. So what are the benefits? There's a ton of benefits, the least of which is feeling better and increasing energy, especially if you do this in the morning. Again, not required, but for me, that works great. It increases mitochondrial efficiency. It also increases your carbohydrate tolerance, especially after a zone 2 workout. It increases insulin sensitivity and glucose disposal. This is also really important because as we age, our bodies become less carbohydrate and insulin sensitive, and our bodies have a harder time processing that, which can lead to things like obesity or diabetes. So zone 2 will help stave this off and can actually increase those functions. Another thing to note, and this is not true for everyone, a lot of this is anecdotal, but it can increase quality of sleep or increase deep or restorative sleep. So this is something that you might wanna try and track and check out if this is something that can help you. So how can I do it? What are some examples? Well, research shows maximal benefits occur at 3 to 4 hours per week, but knowing that a lot of us do not have 3 to 4 hours per week, note that doing something is better than doing nothing. Shoot for doing something in the 20 to 30 minute range a couple of times a week. That's a great place to start, and you can always build on that. One of the things you'll note, you'll probably start feeling better and have more energy, and you might want to increase that. If you can get to that 30 minute range, that's really where you're going to see the most benefits, from 30 minutes to 60 minutes per session. As you get more comfortable, you can build that throughout the week. But noting that if you're trying to balance things like zone 2 strength, some VO2 max work, you might not be able to fit all of that in. So a little bit of variety and helping to hit all of those four pillars is going to be really beneficial. And once you start feeling good about hitting those, you might be able to find more time to increase your capacity to fit these in. But again, starting 20 to 30 minute sessions per week is great. If you can get to 45 to 60 minutes per session, that is super ideal. A lot of research shows the benefits in the longevity. Dr. Peter Attia does, I believe, four sessions of 45 to 60 minutes per week. One of the recommendations, especially if you're starting out, is 5 or 6% incline on a treadmill with a fast walk or a light jog. This will get your heart rate up and also has a lot less impact than running. For me, I stick to a lot of running, biking, or rowing. I shoot for a 140 heart rate, but 130 to 140 is a good range for me. Again, I do not have lactate testing. I want to stick into the aerobic range without going too high. You don't want it to be super easy or too hard. You want it to be a challenging effort where you could talk, but it's not comfortable. If you start getting too fast or too hard with your heart rate, you're starting to move into the anaerobic training, and really you want to then just save that for an all-out hard VO2 max workout. That in-between range, really you'd hit that if you're training for something specific like a sport or a race. So really in this zone two, you want to stick to a range that's hard but not too hard. As I said, I do a mix of biking, running, rowing. I've only been doing this for about a couple of years. I was primarily running when I first started out. Now I mix between the three just to get some variation, hit different muscle systems. It does decrease some fatigue and soreness by not having one specific action or movement too many times throughout the week. So in running, I'll show you an example here. I usually stick between the 140 heart rate range. Sometimes it'll vary between 135, 145. Noting that at the beginning of my run, my heart rate's gonna be a little bit lower. Usually after about 10 minutes, that's when it stabilizes. I've found my pace to be about 9.5 to 10 minutes for that 140 beats per minute. On a treadmill, it tends to be a little bit faster. I will also say in the biking, I actually have a hard time getting my heart rate up, partially because my leg strength doesn't match my cardio fitness. So I'm lucky if I can hit 120 beats per minute. That does not mean that I'm super fit or something. It just means that if I crank the resistance higher to get my heart rate up, I can't go very long because my legs get tired and I have to kind of poop out a little bit. So if I move my arms and kind of do some pumping or moving them up and down, I can get a little bit more of that heart rate going. So biking, I usually try to do that once or twice a week, rower once or twice a week, and then running a couple times, maybe three times per week. So just intermixing those throughout. I definitely do not have time to hit the 60 minute mark. If I can get 40 minutes, that's awesome. If I hit 30, I'm good with that. Occasionally it's just 20. So this is just one example of aerobic efficiency, part of Dr. Peter's four pillars of exercise. But remember, if you're not doing any of them and you want to jump into at least one of them, this is a great place to start. Don't overwhelm yourself. Start small, do something, you'll feel better. I know that I do. You don't have to be perfect. You do want to avoid injury, so it's something you want to be really mindful of. Build up some habits and build up some routines and help yourself to feel good about it. You'll feel effective and it will inspire you to want to do more. I'll be creating more videos, routines, and protocols I have learned and I'm currently practicing specific to Dr. Peter Attia's pillars of exercise, as well as sleep, nutrition, tracking, and lots of other topics. I'll be putting links into the description below. Be sure to subscribe and like this video to stay up to date on new videos, and please comment or send questions on what you would like to know or what you want more details on. Thank you for listening, and here's to life and fitness. Peace out.
Afraid of what you might lose, walking miles and someone else's shoes.